in my words, and you know, well, you kind of close your eyes in prayer for a second, and you're like, what's happened here? They got a big swap going on. Well, we wanted to show you that from Pastor Jeff Bucknam, who's our lead pastor of all of Harvest this morning, in particular, as he wanted to speak to us regarding, obviously, the issue of the joy of journey of generosity and giving and those kind of pieces as well, and just good opportunity to hear from him. And you'll hear from him periodically, but no, he's not preaching this morning here. He's preaching at one of the other campuses, of course. So you have the distinct joy and privilege of being with me this morning. So, you can applaud. That's nice of you. If you don't have a Bible, we have Bibles below you or in front of you in the chairs, in the racks. You can pull one of those out. It's page 571. That should take you to the book of Isaiah in the Old Testament. We are going to be in Isaiah chapter 6. That's on page 571 in your Bibles. Now, I think it's really safe to say, as you've kind of hear a lot these days, it's safe to say that we're living in some pretty crazy times, right? Times, I think that those of us who are familiar with the Bible would say, boy, these are certainly days that are very similar to the days of the judges in the Old Testament, the book of Judges, where everyone seems to be doing what is right in their own eyes. Moral relativism is rampant, right? Like objective moral reality, objective morality has been pushed aside. Moral relativism certainly is the dominant theme of today, where everybody simply does whatever they think is right, whatever truth is to them. And many people have just simply swapped out the God of the Bible for all kinds of other false gods. This kind of thing is nothing new in our world, right? I mean, I think we do see that maybe we're living in some times that are far more intense and far more crazy, but the craziness has always been around. Right? We're just dealing with a whole level of intensity of craziness now. I watched the other day a video from a guy on Instagram, and I'm one of those kind of dads that scrolls through Instagram and sends his kids 100 Instagram reels to watch that I think are funny, that they're like, Dad, why'd you send me 600 of these? I've become one of those dads. But I was scrolling through, and I get really irritated at times at some of the ones. And, you know, when you start watching one, then they send you all the ones that are like that. But there was this old guy on the screen, and he had this shirt on, black and white shirt. And I thought, this guy really needs a PR manager or something, first of all, to help him with his Instagram reels. But he was saying, Christianity is done. It's all over. The death of Christianity is upon us. Soon all the Jesus stuff will be over. It's coming to an end. It's coming to a conclusion. The church is in decline. Christianity's in decline. And this will soon be wiped off the face of the earth. And I thought, this guy clearly doesn't know what he's talking about. Now, he's wishful thinking. Certainly, when you look at the church and the history of the church, that's the first lesson that you want to look at. In the history of the Christian church, you can look back when you study church history, and you can see the church has been through some unbelievably dark times. And when I say the church, I'm not talking about our church here. I'm talking about Christ's church all over the globe. The church has been through horrible seasons in its history. Dark, dark times. Times when people would look in and they'd wonder, where is the church? Where is God in the midst of all of this? And you know what God does is he breaks into that and he brings about revivals. I mean, just think about the first great awakening. Think about the second great awakening, which is not all that long ago in terms of the history of the Christian church. God broke in and did amazing things. And so I have no doubt that God can and will do that sort of thing again. And when you say that the church is in decline, the church is falling apart, or Christianity is coming to end, I got news for you, buddy. Jesus said in Matthew 16, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. So I think I'm going to go with Jesus on this, because he said it is going to be forever. It will not end. You see, no matter what people do to the church will always succeed, because you will never be able to snuff out the church. You'll never be able to destroy God's truth and God's word and God's people. You see, the greatest threat to the church is the church itself, right? It's the inside. That's where the greatest threat is. It's not the outside. In fact, it's usually when the outside presses in on the church that the church finally wakes up and says, oh man, like let's smell the coffee here this morning and let's get active with the gospel. right? So this guy in his video is coming from sort of a Western lens. He's looking at it going, yeah, if you're looking North America, but you know what, buddy, you need to get a bigger picture because the world is a whole lot bigger than the United States of America, and it's a whole lot better than the entire Western world. There are places where the church is thriving throughout the world, where God is reaching thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people with the gospel. So, that's the good news. But you know, when we're living in dark times, it's really easy to think dark thoughts. It's really easy to think and wonder where in the world God is. But I've got the good news for you today, and that is, no matter how far we might feel the nation or the church has drifted away from God, we must not lose hope because God is always at work. He never ceases working, even in the darkest moments. And he's still sovereign over all. And he's always on the lookout, and he's always at work, not only on the lookout, but also bringing up, raising up individuals who will stand in the gap as his agents of reformation and transformation. I mean, just again, go through the history of the Christian church and see who God has raised up strategically at certain points in time to accomplish his work. Work that they didn't plan on doing. They didn't say, I'm going to reform, or I'm going to transform, or I'm going to revive. The people that think that usually don't do it. It's simply that God swept in on individuals who are pursuing him, and God did a miracle in and through them. And great things took place. So God is, I think, still today, as he's always been, looking for and searching for those who have a heart for him, people that he can use. He's looking for one person. Because one person can make an enormous difference. One individual in the Old Testament, since we're in this series in the prophets, that comes to my mind on this is the prophet Isaiah. And that's why this morning we are in Isaiah chapter 6. We're going to look at the first 13 verses of Isaiah chapter 6 because Isaiah in this passage is called by God and he has a vision given to him. But I want you to know before we read this passage that there's five chapters that come before this, aren't there? It's in chapter 6 that he hears from God, but the first five chapters paint this picture of Israel at that time of living in wickedness and wandering in sin, where everybody was doing what was right in their own eyes. They were calling bad good and good bad, and they were doing the kinds of things like parading the sins of Sodom right in the open in the streets. It was a wicked time. And then God calls this one man to be a prophet in the midst of this horrible situation in the nation. Let's read from Isaiah chapter 6 this morning. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And he called to one another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, Woe is me! For I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for. And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, Whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then I said, Here I am, send me. And he said, Go and say to this people, Keep on hearing, but do not understand. Keep on seeing, but do not perceive. Make the heart of this people dull and their ears heavy, and blind their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and turn and be healed? Then I said, how long, O Lord? And he said, until cities lie waste without inhabitant, and houses without people, and the land is a desolate waste. And the Lord removes people far away, and the forsaken places are many in the midst of the land. And though a tenth remain in it, it will be burned again, like a terebinth or an oak whose stump remains when it is felled. The holy seed is its stump. In this particular passage here in Isaiah chapter 6, Isaiah gets a call from God. He receives actually from God, after all these first five chapters paint this sort of picture of darkness and gloom that exists in the land. You could wonder when you read those first five chapters, you could think, how's this going to change? How's this ever going to be fixed? I mean, the situation is dreadful. And God then appears. He manifests himself. He gives to Isaiah a vision, and he gives him a call. And this vision that he has actually three components to it that I want to give you this morning. And if you're following along with your notes, you can certainly do that and look at these three components in the text along with me. The first thing I want you to note is that Isaiah had a vision of the Lord. It all starts right there. And I want you to notice the first verse, even in how that begins in chapter 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne. Notice the simple contrast that's here. Not only is the nation an absolute mess, but now King Uzziah, who is actually for the most part in Israel, one of the better kings. Now this king has died, or he's going to preach in the year that he dies. It's a little bit unclear exactly if he starts his ministry after his death or a little bit before. It's hard to say exactly. But now you have the king that's likely dead, and the nation has fallen apart. And at this point, when this kind of thing happens, it's easy for people to sort of have things spin out of control because they look in at the physical things of this world, the tangible. But I want you to notice what the text says, you see. Where is God when everything is falling apart? Already in chapter 6, verse 1, he's on his throne. That's where he is. You see, the earthly king Uzziah was on the throne and he dies. But fear not, in other words, because Isaiah says, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim, each having six wings. With two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. That's the picture that we're given here right away when Isaiah has a vision of the Lord. And what does Isaiah see in this vision? He sees that, yes, the earthly king is done and the nation is falling apart. But when things are like that, you need to know, Isaiah, that God is still on his throne. The one who is seated upon a throne, who's high and lifted up, has this magnificent, glorious image of him with his train filling the temple. Now, I personally think that the temple that's in view here is not the temple on earth in Jerusalem, and not everybody sees it that way, but I will say from my perspective, this is a glimpse that Isaiah gets of glory, actually, of heaven. He's seeing a heavenly temple. He's actually getting a glimpse into glory itself. He's getting to see this, and he sees God on his throne in this glorious temple. So, where is God in the midst of all the chaos and calamity of the land around them? He's there. Where is God when all seems hopeless and lost? He's there. Where is God right now when you're looking around at the nation or you look at the world? He's on his throne. It's easy to forget that. And in God's powerful revelation to Isaiah, where he gives him this vision, Isaiah sees the majesty of the king, how majestic he is. And he actually sees how glorious he is. I want you to think about what is being described in this passage for a moment. He describes not only the Lord, which, by the way, this first reference to Lord, you'll notice it's all in lowercase other than the first letter, capital L, and then lowercase O-R-D. That is different than capital L-O-R-D, which means Yahweh. But in the same text, in verse 3 or verse 4, he is clearly called, capital L-O-R-D. He's clearly called Yahweh. We're talking about Lord, who's Yahweh, capital L-O-R-D, and L-O-R-D, so mostly lowercase, is the word Adonai in Hebrew. It's actually the word that carries this idea of majesty. It's kind of a term that you would use in reference to the king, right? So here is the picture in contrast to King Uzziah. I saw the Lord. I saw the one who is majestic sitting upon this throne. He's high and lifted up. His train fills the temple. But now notice the scene. Above him are these things that are referred to as the seraphim. You know, this is the only place in the entire Old Testament where the word seraphim is used. It's not used anywhere else. It's actually a word that means burning ones. These are the burning ones. A lot of people will tell you that these are angels, and they could be right. But I think what we do want to know about this vision is that there's angels and then there's angels. Okay, there's garden variety angels, and then there's the cherubim and the seraphim. And we refer to them as angelic creatures. But there's also, for example, in Revelation chapter 7, verse 11, a clear distinction made between all the angels and the living creatures, or the cherubim and seraphim. They are a different breed of cat, so to speak. Well, they're not cats, they're angels. So here you have these angelic type beings, and I want you to sort of imagine, you know, when we get a... In the New Testament, for example, or Old Testament, when an angel appears to an individual, usually it's pretty stunning, it's pretty glorious, but they often appear in a physical human form. They manifest. There's, you know, the angel Gabriel comes in the birth narrative of Jesus. In this case, these are not the angels that are coming down for that. This is a vision that Isaiah has. He sees in glory, and he sees around the throne, above the throne, are the seraphim, and there's actually several of them. In other places in Scripture, most likely four. And they may be the exact same as the cherubim and seraphim, because they're often described very similar. Look at what they're like. They have, we're told in this text, six wings. With two, they cover their face. With two, their feet. And with two, they fly. Six wings. Why are they, in this depiction of the seraphim, why are they covering their face? Because the scene of God in all of his majesty and glory is far too much for them to even look upon. The level of reverence and awe in this text is off the charts. And not only do they have wings that cover their eyes so they don't look upon God's glory, but they also have wings that cover their feet. You know, our feet are kind of, well, I'm wearing sandals because I want to walk as Jesus walked, and he wore sandals. Talk to me in the winter when I'm not walking like Jesus walked. But, you know, we look at our feet typically as kind of that part of our anatomy where, like, well, we don't often like to show our feet, right? It's sort of like, you know, kind of, they're more about our humanness. Here, even these angelic-like beings are covering their feet in the presence of God. And so here are these beings that are around him, they're encircling the throne, or actually above him, and they are crying out, saying loud, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." So they're caught up in the majesty and the glory of God, and they will not look at him. And they, at the same time, in this text, we are told, are crying out because they see how holy God is. How completely set apart, how completely other he is. For that's what it is to be holy, right? Completely other, completely set apart from all that's impure and unclean. There's not a smidgen, a little bit of darkness in God at all. Not at all, 1 John tells us. In him there is no darkness at all, the text says. And they cry out with these words. Now, I don't know if you've made this connection before. So this text talks about the seraphim. A lot of texts in the Old Testament, or several of them, refer to the other group of angelic beings, which I said may be actually the seraphim as well. They're called the cherubim. When the temple in Israel was built in the Old Testament, in Exodus 25, they're talking about the building of the temple. And when you get to 1 Kings chapter 6, for example, you read about it again, the construction of the temple. There is, in the temple, the Holy of Holies. Right? That's the place where only the high priest would go once a year. And in the Holy of Holies, there was the Ark of the Covenant, or the known as the mercy seat. And beside the Ark of the Covenant, they were images of the cherubim. And the dimensions are actually given of the size of the Holy of Holies. And the dimensions are actually given in 1 Kings as well of the cherubim. Did you know that if you did the math on it, because they're done in cubits, let me give you a little picture and ask the question, is this sort of a depiction of the reality? I think it quite likely is. Because the earthly temple is really a reflection of what was in glory, right? What was in heaven. But the earthly depiction is this. Those cherubim were 15 feet tall in the Holy of Holies. And they had a wingspan. Each of them had a wingspan of 15 feet. 15 feet tall with a 15-foot wingspan. And those two cherubim that are in the Holy of Holies, their wings would touch. So these two enormous angelic-like creatures standing over the Ark of the Covenant, the mercy seat, where God would show up in his glory, they would stand beside each other and their wings would touch 30 feet in width. I don't know the dimensions of this room, but just try to imagine that in your mind. Now try to imagine that you're Isaiah and you get a vision of the Lord and you see the Lord, he's seated on a throne, he's high and lifted up, and the train of his robe is filling the temple. And then the cherubim are there, and there are these potentially these 15-foot enormous creatures. Now, I don't know about you, but I would freak right out at that point. I mean, I see a spider and a bug, and I tend to freak out. And the depiction, how these are described in Scripture, is breathtaking. With six wings. But I think what we're supposed to know and understand as we dive into this text is that it all begins here with a clear, crisp vision of the Lord that Isaiah has, where he gets to see the majestic nature of who God is, that he is the true king who rules over all, that he's seated on his throne, he is glorious, and he is of incredible holiness. Because not just once do they say holy, but they say twice, and not just twice, holy, holy, but they say three times, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. You know, it's been pointed out by scholars that when Jesus was here on earth, what did he say? He would often introduce some of his teachings with, truly, truly, I say to you. It's actually literally in Greek, amen, amen. Amen, amen, I say to you. He would begin his speech sometimes with amen, when we would close sometimes with amen. Right? He begins with amen. And it's sort of a Hebrew way of repeating is to drive home a point, right? Well, this is also uniquely Hebrew in that it drives home the infinite holiness of God. And I think personally some people have gone wrong with this a little bit when they start seeing the Trinity in holy, holy, holy. Yes, the Trinity's biblical, but I don't think the statement holy, holy, holy is a reflection of the Trinity. It's a way of saying that you are standing, Isaiah, right in the very presence of him who is infinitely holy, majestic, and glorious. Now, I don't know about you, but I wonder what would happen in my life if I was to catch a glimpse of that glory? What would happen in my life if I was to see the Lord like that, seated on a throne high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filling this heavenly temple? And what would happen if I was to see those incredible angelic-type creatures around the throne, singing out, crying out, holy, 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 and covering their faces. You know, we don't have the opportunity to dive into this more, and we may next week, in fact, as we possibly go into the book of Ezekiel, but did you know that these angels that are around the throne serve different purposes? So these particular angels, the seraphim or the cherubim, they were very unique among the other types of angels. Because these angels, one of which at one point was Lucifer, actually, wasn't he? You look at Ezekiel chapter 28, he's referred to as the guardian cherub. And he had fallen away. He actually rebelled against God and he was cast down to the earth. He's referred to in Ezekiel 20 as the guardian cherub. You see, they were guardians of the throne. They were protectors of the throne. And one of the things that we find in Scripture, when we think about these majestic creatures that we call the living creatures or the cherubim or the seraphim, is that these creatures formed what we refer to as God's chariot. God has a chariot. Now, it's made up of these living creatures. And that's why there's four of them. And as you read Ezekiel, there's four wheels, and each living creature has a wheel, and there's a wheel within a wheel, and there's eyes all around the wheels. And what God does in several places in the Old Testament is when he leaves his throne to come down to earth, he comes riding down on his guardian cherubs, on his chariot. You've heard the phrase, swing low, sweet chariot. That's where it's from. It comes from this idea. You see, God's chariot comes down. In the book of Ezekiel, it comes down, and Ezekiel gets this vision, and then the chariot, God's presence is there on the cherubim, and he resides in the temple, and when he pronounces judgment on the temple in Ezekiel 10, he goes up with his chariot, and the living creatures, they go up with him. And they're described in such an incredible way in Ezekiel 1, and perhaps next week we will take a deeper dive on it. I wanted to give you a glimpse of that, to see imagine the kind of scene that Isaiah would be gripped with here. And as Isaiah was no doubt deeply gripped by it, seeing such a magnificent, glorious vision and hearing those angels crying out with this, seeing them guarding their own eyes from actually looking at God's glory, what is Isaiah's response? Well, that leads us secondly to this, that Isaiah had a vision of himself. So he saw God's glory, he saw God's majesty, he saw the Lord on his throne, but secondly, he sees himself. In this vision of himself, he sees two truths that come out that really sort of, I guess, hit him in the face, if you want to put it that way. First of all, he saw his sinfulness. How could you not see your own sinfulness when you step into the very presence of God? And you see God's infinite holiness, majesty, and glory. Notice, for example, in verse 5, what Isaiah's response is. And I said, this is his response now to the vision. I said, woe is me, for I am lost. For I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. I am ruined because of what my eyes have just seen. I mean, this God that we worship is not even these angels that are around his throne would even remove their wings from his eyes to look, and I have seen him. So what happens when a finite, sinful, and unholy person encounters the one and only infinite, pure, righteous, and holy God? What happens? Well, what happens with Isaiah? You see, those who encounter God's presence, if you think through these accounts in the Old Testament, often those who encounter the presence of God have a response, much like, for example, Abraham in Genesis 17, who fell on his face. Joshua in Joshua chapter 5, he fell on his face. Ezekiel in chapter 1 and 3, he falls on his face. Daniel, he falls on his face. In fact, he's not only on his face, but he's exhausted from the encounter with God. He's literally drained from it, and God has to pick him up and put him back on his feet. And then there's the soldiers. You remember the arrest of Jesus? Do you remember those soldiers who came to arrest Jesus, and they approach him and they say, "Are you the one?" And he says, "I am." And at his statement of "I am," what happens? They draw back and they fall to the ground. They had no idea what hit them. They were in the presence of God at that moment, I think, and were struck by it. And then, of course, there's Peter, who does the same thing. Paul, who falls to his knees in Acts chapter 9. There's John in Revelation chapter 1, verse 17. All of these individuals fall on their faces before God because they're struck by his majesty, glory, his power, and they fall prostrate before him in awe of him. Now, that's a word you don't hear a lot of today. We hear the word awesome. Like, that coffee was awesome. Man, that ride was awesome. But if we really think about awe, to recapture in our day clarity and understanding and a sense of the awe that we should have in the presence of our God for who he is. In this text in chapter 6, verse 5, we find Isaiah has a similar response, doesn't he, to these other Old Testament saints who saw the Lord and they thought that they would die. Repeatedly in the Old Testament, we have example after example of these Old Testament believers who would say something like Isaiah said, something similar to it, like, "I've seen the Lord and I'm done. I am undone." The truth of the matter is that none of them actually saw the Lord in all of his glory. The Bible tells us that no one has seen God, because no one could see God and live. So even in those encounters, somehow God's fullness of his glory was somehow veiled from them so that they could not see it otherwise for mankind to look upon the pure holiness of God, the infinite glory of God, the beauty and majesty of God. They would be undone. But nonetheless, God gave a vision of himself to Isaiah, and that vision wrecked Isaiah in that moment. He felt the weight of his own sin. Woe is me. I am lost. Like the nation of Israel around me that's been described in Isaiah chapter 1 through 5, I am a man of unclean lips. I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. My eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. I'm in trouble. I want you to consider another text. It's found in the Gospel of Luke in chapter 5. This one is about Peter. You see, what Isaiah experienced wasn't just unique to Isaiah, and it's not unique to just the Old Testament. In fact, in the New Testament, we have the Apostle Peter. We learn about his interaction that he had with Jesus on one particular occasion. It was near the beginning of Peter being called as a disciple. In fact, this is, I think, probably the second interaction that Peter has had with Jesus. The first one, he didn't leave everything to follow his nets. This one, he does. In Luke chapter 5, it says, on one occasion, while the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, and he saw two boats by the lake, but the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. Getting into one of the boats, which was Simon's, he asked him to put out a little from the land, and he sat down and taught the people from the boat. And when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch." And Simon answered, "Master, we toiled all night and took nothing, but at your word I will let down the nets." And when they had done this, they enclosed a large number of fish, and their nets were breaking. They signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both boats, so they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I'm a sinful man, O Lord." You see, he came to understand who Jesus is in this passage. He recognized that in the presence of Jesus, he's in the presence of God himself, and he couldn't help but see his own sin. And he falls down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Leave, Lord." But Jesus doesn't do that with him. You see, there has to come a point in our lives where where we recognize the sinfulness in our own condition. We have to realize that we are sinful people. We have to acknowledge that. We have to confess that. And we have to see it in contrast to who God is, that we are not basically in and of ourselves, in our own sort of nature, we're not good people. We're sinful people. We've fallen short of the glory of God. We've been born into this world. We've not just been tainted by sin, but we've been marred and scarred and ruined by sin. It's ravished us. And that sin manifests itself in individuals' lives in a multitude of different ways. And it's only when we recognize that we are sinners that we can really experience the mercy and the grace of God. Isaiah, in that moment, saw the Lord. And it was his vision of God's holiness and his beauty and his majesty that made him cry out, "Lord, I see how sinful I am. I'm ruined." You see, if that's all you see, if that's all you see when you bump up into the presence of God, or if that's all you've ever been told is that you're a wretched, no good, lousy sinner, well, that's only part of the truth. You see, because if that's all you ever hear is that you're a sinner, then you walk out of a place going, "I have no hope." But God never leaves us without the hope. The gospel is always including the hope, because the gospel is all about hope. So Peter falls down and says, "Depart from me, I'm a sinful man, O Lord." But Jesus says to him, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you're going to go catching men. You're going to be a fisher of men. You're going to be part of my team. You're going to be the one of the ones I've called. Now I'm going to send you out to do the." God was looking for one. Jesus was looking for one, and he found Peter. Just like he was looking for one in Isaiah's day and he found Isaiah. You see, such is the impact upon us when we as sinful beings encounter the holiness of God. And I dare say what we probably need more desperately than anything in our day and in the North American church is we need an awakening to this and a revival to this, to the presence of God, to his majesty, his glory, his power. We need that in our lives. You see, because apart from the presence of God, what else is there? To feel the weight of his presence. And that brings up then in us the weight of our own burden and sin. So in this vision of himself, Isaiah first and foremost, in contrast to what he saw in his vision of God, saw himself, he saw his own sinfulness. But secondly, he saw his need for atonement. Oh, it's so clear in this text, isn't it? To have his sins atoned, to have his sins taken away. In chapter 6, verse 6 and 7, God does atone for his sin, and Isaiah couldn't atone for his own sin. He couldn't do anything about it. There was absolutely nothing Isaiah could do to clean up his own act. Notice in Isaiah chapter 6, verse 6 and 7, after he declares, "Lord, I am ruined, I'm lost, I've seen you," we get the calm, reassuring words of verse 6. Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, "Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for." What a magnificent picture. If you think about the temple in the Old Testament, which I mentioned, I think this personally is probably referring to a heavenly temple. And I think we're supposed to understand the language here is that there isn't probably literally an altar in heaven and that's made of material, right? Like there's not an actual building in heaven, right? These are all sort of spirit, it's a spiritual temple where God dwells, right, with his angelic beings. But the point remains, nonetheless, that this was the understanding of the Jews in the Old Testament, wasn't it? How did you have your sins atoned for? You would go to the temple and you would actually offer an animal in sacrifice. And here the seraphim, the burning ones, what do? They go to this altar, they take with the tongs a burning coal and they touch his lips and his sin is atoned for. Now, for us as followers of Jesus, we don't stop there, do we? In fact, I want to suggest to you that if you go into your community groups or you look at the questions this week, take a little bit of a deep dive in John chapter 12, starting in verse 37. Guess who Isaiah sees? When he says, "I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and lifted up." John tells us that he sees Jesus. Now, he's not Jesus at that point. He hasn't taken upon his human self. He's God, the second person of the Trinity. That's who he sees in this incredible vision. And so you hear, you have this seraphim who comes, and the way in which we think about atonement today is we certainly see also our own sinfulness, we see our need for atonement, but the time is past of the Old Testament. The time is past of the cleansing of sin through the sacrificial system. Now we're cleansed from our sins simply by the person of Jesus himself. If you look, for example, at 1 John chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, this is what we're told about atonement in the New Testament in 1 John 2, verse 1 and 2. My little children, I'm writing these things to you that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Or some of you may have a translation even that says that he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. That means propitiation. Jesus, the one who turned away the wrath of God the Father that was pointed at you and me because of our sin, he himself, as the person who hung upon the cross, is our hilasmos in Greek. He's the one who turned the sin or turned the wrath of God away from us onto Christ so that Christ took the punishment for us. That's how Jesus became, he's the atoning sacrifice for our sins. So now we come to Jesus, don't we? And 1 John 1, 9 tells us that if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all of our unrighteousness. You see, for God to use Isaiah to stand in the gap, because God was looking for just one person in that dark time, he first needed a vision from God. That's what Isaiah needed. And then secondly, he needed to see his own sin and experience the weight of that sin. And then he needed, because of that sin and the weight of the sin in his life, he needed desperately to have his sins covered and atoned for, to be dealt with by God. And God did all that for him. It was God who gave him the vision. It was God who helped him to see his own sin. It was God who provided the atonement for his sin. And God is looking for someone then, even in our day, who has encountered his presence, who's experienced his forgiveness, and who seeks to be holy as God is holy. You see, these are the kinds of people that God chooses to use. I mean, God can use anybody he wants. But when you think about the kind of person that God sets apart for his purposes, his holy purpose and plan, often it is the person who's marked by an encounter with him in his presence, who experiences the forgiveness of God, knows what it's like, and who seeks to be holy as he is holy. For this reason, Peter tells us as obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance. But as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. Since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 20, we're told that in a great house there's not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, some for honorable use and some for dishonorable. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from what is dishonorable, he will be a useful vessel for honorable use, set apart as holy, useful to the master of the house, ready for every good work. So flee youthful passions and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace along with those who call on the Lord from a pure heart. You see, this is the disposition and the posture of the follower of Jesus' heart. Lord, I've seen you in your glory and in your majesty. Lord, I've seen the wretchedness of my own sin. Lord, please forgive me and have mercy upon my soul. Please cleanse me from my sin, and thank you, Jesus, for doing that. And Lord, I want to be holy. I want to be a vessel for you. So to be useful to the master and set apart as holy and a vessel for honorable use, cleansing is absolutely needed in our lives. And it's not just when you become a follower of Jesus Christ that you receive that forgiveness at that moment. There are times as followers of Jesus when we have to get right with God because we allow garbage into our lives. And how's God going to use us when we're filthy? Now, I say that, and I recognize God can use anyone. But I think we know and understand the clear teaching of Scripture is that God expects us to be a certain kind of people. And it's those people that are his vessels and instruments that he uses for his glory. So I ask you this morning, are you in need of a fresh encounter with God? Do you need to come clean with God? Are there things in your life, or is there a thing in your life that keeps you from intimacy with God? That if you were to have a vision of God's glory and his majesty today, tonight, sometime, and you were to see those angelic creatures gathered around saying, "Holy, holy, holy," would you, like Isaiah, fall on your face and say, "Depart from me, Lord, I'm a sinful man," or, "Lord, I'm undone, I'm ruined, I'm finished because I've seen you"? Sometimes we need to gut it out with God, don't we? Yeah. We need to be honest with ourselves. We need to confess and we need to repent of sin in our lives, things we've been involved in, that God would cleanse us so that we might be holy people. Oh, we live in such a time where there's so many opportunities for walking in darkness. We live in a time much like Isaiah's. We look around in our nation, in the world. It's so dark in so many areas. And we live in a time when we can hide like probably never before and engage in sin like never before because of simply things like social media, the internet. But God wants a clean people. You see, it was only after Isaiah had a vision of God and a vision of himself and was deeply affected by that vision that Isaiah heard God speak to him and he received the third component of the vision. And that's where he had a vision of the mission. A vision of the mission at this point. In Isaiah chapter 6, starting in verse 8, after he is cleansed, notice, not before, but after, you see, because commissioning comes after consecration. It doesn't come before. Verse 8, "And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send and who will go for us?' Then I said," this is Isaiah speaking, "'Here I am, send me.'" And then in verse 9, all the way down to verse 13, God said, okay, you're going to go. You're going to go to these people. But you see, Isaiah gets this vision of the mission, and in this he sees, first of all, we see that he's willing to go, isn't he? He's willing to go. His heart has been cleansed. He's been made right with God. He's seen a vision of glory. How could he not go? "Here I am, send me." Jesus gave us a pretty clear mission, didn't he? He sure did. In Matthew chapter 28, the mission was so crystal clear, wasn't it? He talked about making disciples of all the nations and baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We're supposed to go and to make disciples. In Acts chapter 1, he said to the church, he said, "You're going to receive power soon. The Holy Spirit's going to come upon you, and you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." Friends, the work is far from over. The mission is still the same today. It's not changed. You see, we got to go. We got to go. We got to make disciples. That's what we're called to do. We're called to tell people about Jesus. In the Isaiah-type days that we live in, the call is still loud and clear from God, and he's looking for one. And what God told Isaiah is that he should also be faithful regardless of fruit. We want fruit. We want fruit. We want to see the evidence, the fruit of our work, our labors, don't we? That's natural and normal. But what God told Isaiah is, go and speak these words to the people. Keep on hearing, but do not understand. Keep on seeing, but do not perceive. In other words, you're going to go to stubborn, obstinate Israel, and I'm telling you right now, Isaiah, they need to hear from you, but they're not going to listen to a word you have to say. And then Isaiah asked, like, for how long, Lord? Like, how long do I need to do this? Starting in verse 11. And the Lord says to him, be faithful to the end, until the cities lie waste without inhabitant and houses without people, the land is a desolate waste. Until the Babylonians come in and absolutely destroy it all, you keep on preaching, you keep on doing what you've been asked to do. In other words, I'm not really so concerned, Isaiah, that you are fruitful, I'm concerned that you are faithful. You see, and the exact same thing is true for us today, isn't it? God doesn't look at us to produce the fruit because we don't do the fruit producing. He simply wants you and I, out of our own uniqueness, our own DNA, uniqueness that we bring, to bring our best to Him and say, Lord, here am I. Send me. Talk to your neighbors. Talk to your friends. Talk to the people that are around you. Seek opportunities to share the love of Christ and the gospel. Look for inroads. Look for opportunities. But you got to be in places where there's relationships. You got to be involved with people. You got to be in and around the people having conversations. And if all you do is hang out in a holy huddle in church all the time, and you're not with other people who are lost, you'll never ever have the opportunity, the privilege of ever leading someone to Jesus. We have to be out there. And it's amazing how the conversations will develop. So God is looking for one. So will you be the one? Will you say yes to His call to spread the gospel? Will you go where He wants you to go and say what He wants you to say and do what He wants you to do? You know, if it's not you, then who? Right? If it's not now, then when? If it's not here, then where? The call is the same for every follower of Jesus. You've seen His glory. You've seen His majesty. You've seen how holy He is. You feel the weight of your own sin, and you've experienced the freedom of forgiveness through Jesus Christ. And there's a world out there that doesn't know anything about that. And that's why we need to go. So I ask you this morning to stand in the gap for a generation that is lost and in need of the gospel that we preach from God's word. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that you love us so much, Lord. So reflected in Isaiah, how much you love us as your people. That, Lord, your love is evident all over the text in Isaiah 6. If you didn't love your people, you wouldn't have bothered to call Isaiah. You wouldn't have bothered to give him a vision of who you are. You wouldn't have bothered to relieve him of the burden and weight of his sin. And you wouldn't bother to send us on mission. Lord, it's because of your great love for us that we go. So this week, Lord, I pray first and foremost, Lord, if we haven't caught a glimpse of you, would this week somehow in some way, would you reveal yourself to us that we could see you more clearly? Lord, that you would also reveal to us the sin in our lives and, Lord, where it is that we need to repent and confess that we might be clean. And Lord, would you help us then, out of all of our weakness and frailty, to just faithfully go on mission with you. And we just offer ourselves up to you now for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen.